Hello guys, welcome back to my channel. And today we'll be doing a special integral today that is based in a lot of ways on the previous integral that we did, sine of x over x. So without any further delay, let's get to it. So the problem is I, which is defined as the integral from 0 to infinity of sine cubed of x over x squared dx. So instead of our previous integral, we have a cube term this time. Sine cubed, not just regular sine, divided by x squared, not just a regular x. So you have the denominator squared. Now looking at the sine cubed term in the numerator, we beg to ask the question, can we simplify the sine cube and, you know, break it down into simpler trigonometric chunks? Well, the answer again is yes, because we have many trigonometric identities that we can use. So let's see which one of them are we going to use for this one. So today let's look at the sine triple angle formula. So sine of 3x is equal to 3 times the sine of x minus 4 times sine cubed of x. Well, why don't we try to make the sine cubed term the subject of the equation? So, you know, performing some simple algebra, we get sine cubed x is equal to 3 times the sine of x minus the sine of 3x everything divided by 4. So why don't we make this substitution in our numerator part, and you'll see in a minute how this is really helpful. So now we have our integral I as the integral from 0 to infinity of, instead of the sine cube, now we have 1 over 4 can be taken outside, 3 times sine x minus sine of 3x everything divided by an x squared term and a dx. And now by the linearity of the integral, we can split this up into two separate integrals. So 3 over 4 outside, integral from 0 to infinity of sine of x over x squared dx minus 1 over 4 times the integral from 0 to infinity of the sine of 3x divided by x squared dx. So now basically we have two integrals, right? So let's call this part I1, and this part, excluding the negative, I'm not taking the negative this time, I2. And this was I, right? So I can be regarded as I1 minus I2. So as always, let's do each of them on separate fresh pages, and we'll plug them back together by the end of the video. Now let's do part 1. So we had our I1 defined as 3 over 4 times the integral from 0 to infinity of sine of x over x squared dx. Now if you compare this integrand to my previous video's integrand, we have an x squared term, right? So could we in some way reduce the power of x squared to, you know, to a power of 1 so that we just obtain an x? Well, we could do that because a key observation again is that the derivative of 1 over x is negative 1 over x squared, which means the antiderivative of 1 over x squared with respect to x is nothing but negative 1 over x plus the constant of integration c. So, you know, this, you know why this observation is so important? Because now we can actually look at performing integration by parts on this thing. Because we know that when we integrate 1 over x squared, we have 1 over x, right? So we're reducing the power. So we're going to be integrating that. And therefore, the other part naturally will be differentiating. So on that note, let's perform integration by parts. So our I1 now is going to be 3 over 4 is a constant, and basically for the first term we're going to be taking the antiderivative of 1 over x squared, which is negative 1 over x. So negative, well, the sign stays as it is, the sign of x over x now, because that's the antiderivative. And we'll be subtracting that with, well, 3 over 4 is just another constant now, integral from 0 to infinity of the derivative of sine is a cosine of x, and the antiderivative of 1 over x squared, as I said, is negative 1 over x, and the negative will make a positive dx. And don't forget to evaluate this from 0 to infinity. So, well, I1 is equal to, now let's just plug in our infinities and our zeros and evaluate this thing. Well, so we have a negative 3 over 4 as it is, and we have the limit as x goes to infinity of the sine of x all over x. Minus, and a minus will make a plus, 3 over 4 times the limit as x goes to 0 now, because that's the lower bound, of sine of x over x. And I'll be calling this part, you know, this part that's after the 3 over 4 as j. So we have plus 3 over 4 times our j. Well, now looking at the second part here, the limit as x approaches 0 sine of x over x. Well, that's just a famous limit that we know, right? If you know my limits video, I've made a video on this thing. This thing entirely is going to 1. This is a really famous limit. You can probably look at it using L'Hopital's rule. But why don't we look at this thing now? So, if you refer to my last video, we had a similar condition, but we had an e raised to bx in my previous video. So, the key thing to know here is, as x goes to infinity, sine will just keep oscillating between negative and positive 1. So, it will have some value between them, and we don't know which value. But it's going to be finite, and it's going to be between negative 1 and positive 1. We know that for sure. So in one way, we don't need to care about the sign of x blowing up to infinity as x goes to infinity, because judging by the behavior of the sine function, it's just going to oscillate between negative 1 and positive 1. So assume that to be like a constant value. All we need to worry about is the denominator. So as x goes to infinity, a constant over x is going to zero, right? Because the denominator is getting really, really large. So this thing entirely will go to zero. So we don't care about the first term now. We just have 3 over 4 times 1, which is just 3 over 4. And 3 over 4 times our integral j, which we will do on a fresh page because that's a brand new struggle in itself. But before going to the fresh page, I would like to give you some perspective on this first limit that we had, the limit as extended to infinity. So one way to know that this thing goes to zero is to basically say that, well, sine of x is basically less than equal to 1 and greater than equal to negative 1, right? And why don't we divide x on both the sides? So we have something like this, right? And now why don't we take the limit as x goes to infinity? Well, when that happens, as x goes to infinity, the denominator gets large, really, really large, and this fraction goes to zero. We don't care what sign we have over here because zero times a negative is just zero. Same thing over here, this thing goes to zero too. So in a way, zero is less than or equal to sine of x over x, which is less than or equal to zero. And for this to be true, sine of x over x has to be zero, right? Because look at the inequality here. Or you could just say this is the squeeze theorem. I probably might make a video on this another day, but that's what is actually called the squeeze theorem in mathematics. Or one way to look about it is only way to satisfy this inequality is for sine of x over x to go to zero. So it's like sine of x over x is trapped between the two zeros. The value of this thing is trapped between the two zeros when x tends to infinity. So that's why this is zero. I hope you got a good insight there. So now it's time to actually struggle with J. So we have J being defined as the integral from 0 to infinity of the cosine of x over x dx. And this thing seems quite similar to our last video because in our last video we had a sine of x. Here we have a cosine of x. So since sine and cosine are complementary, the integration method that we're going to use is also the same. So, but if in case you haven't watched my last video, and I'll just provide you a rationale as to why we should use the Leibniz rule. So basically, we need to get rid of this x in the denominator somehow, right? Because in integration, we don't like denominators. We want to get rid of them as soon as possible. So one way of doing that is to introduce a function which, when differentiated, will produce an x term in the numerator, which will cancel off with the denominator x. So why don't we define our generalized J? So call that J of B, being defined as the integral from 0 to infinity of e raised to negative bx times the cosine of x over x dx. And why only in e raised to negative bx? I've actually provided some valuable discussions in my previous video, so please check that out. Now we need to differentiate with respect to b. I'll probably, you know, be brief with my steps because I explained a lot in detail in my last video. So we have negative e raised to negative bx times x times cosine of x divided by x dx. The x will cancel out because this was differentiation with respect to b. So x was treated as a constant. I'll just confirm that with you. So we have the integral from 0 to infinity of negative e raised to negative bx times the cosine of x dx. So why don't we use integration by parts again? Because an exponential function multiplied with a trigonometric function, we know that it's way easier to integrate this and differentiate this. So the antiderivative of e raised to negative bx will compensate the negative, so we don't need to worry about that anymore. So we have j prime of b being equal to e raised to negative bx times cosine of x as it is divided by b because of basically the reverse of the chain rule. We have a coefficient with the argument of the exponential function, so we need to divide by that when we are taking the antiderivative. Evaluated from 0 to infinity, and we have a minus integral from 0 to infinity of e raised to negative bx. This negative is compensated for, and the derivative of the cosine is negative sine, so that negative and this negative will make a positive. Sine of x over b, just like before, dx. So we have j prime of b basically being equal to, when x tends to infinity, cosine will just keep again oscillating between negative 1 and 1, just like sine. It should have some value in between them. We don't know which value, but we know it's going to be between them somewhere. It will have some small finite value between negative 1 and 1. That's what we know. So treating that as like a constant, you could say, well, as e raised to negative bx will basically go to 0 because x is tending to infinity, so this thing will just exponentially decay down to a 0. So entirely this term for the first plugging in operation will basically become 0, minus when we are plugging in 0. So e raised to 0 is 1 and cosine of 0 is 1, so we have 1 over b, which was a constant. But we are still unsatisfied with the integral that we got by performing integration by parts. So we need to again perform integration by parts, but this time I'll be taking a negative 1 over b outside, the negative to compensate with this e raised to negative bx antiderivative, and the b because it was simply a constant from the start. So we'll be having negative 1 over b times antiderivative of this thing is e raised to negative bx sine of x as it is divided by a b again because we're freshly taking an antiderivative. Evaluated from 0 to infinity minus integral from 0 to infinity of e raised to negative bx, and the derivative of the sine is a cosine, and we, you know, this negative will not become a positive because it's just the positive cosine, unlike before. And we have a divided by b again dx. So now j prime of b basically is negative 1 over b, and then again when I say evaluate this function at infinity, as I let x tend to infinity, sine will again oscillate between negative 1 and 1. The e raised to negative bx will decay to 0, which will make the entire term go to 0, and when I plug in 0, e raised to 0 will be 1, but because of the sine of 0 being 0, entirely, again this thing will go to zero. So we don't need to worry about this. And now we have positive, negative and negative positive, 1 over b squared, because they are constants, times the integral from 0 to infinity e raised to negative bx times the cosine of x dx. Now just like my last video, I'm going to equate this integral that we obtained freshly over here, e raised to negative bx times the cosine of x, to our j prime of b function. Our j prime of b was basically negative of that integral. So let's just make appropriate substitutions now. So we have j prime of b is equal to negative 1 over b. Negative j prime of b over b squared. Right? So now this implies I can add this j prime of b over b squared on both sides to get j prime of b. I can take out as a constant. 1 plus 1 over b squared is equal to negative 1 over b. So now cross multiplying quickly, we have j prime of b being equal to b squared plus 1 over b squared is equal to negative 1 over b. Cancel one of the b's off. Finally, cross multiplying, we have j prime of b being equal to negative b over b squared plus 1. Great. Well, now we have to integrate with respect to b now. Well, we know that we are going to integrate, but integrating from what lower bound to what upper bound? So our first bound of integration is going to be, well, when is this j of b being equal to our j? Basically, we want the e raised to negative bx term to be 1. So that's only possible when b is 0. So j, when b is 0, is going to be our j, our original j, unparameterized j. And when is j of b going to be 0? Well, it can only be 0 when e raised to negative bx goes to 0. And when is that possible? When x tends to infinity, right? Because this is an exponentially decaying function. So j when b is equal to, say, infinity. Rather, b tends to infinity is a proper mathematical notation. So that's going to be 0. So why don't we integrate from 0 to infinity? And you'll see in a minute why, if you don't know, if you haven't seen my last video. So let's integrate from 0 to infinity our j prime of b with respect to b, because by the fundamental theorem of calculus, we're going to be having the limit as b approaches infinity of j of b minus the j of 0. And what's the j of 0? Well, that's just our regular j, right? Our original problem that we wanted to figure out. And what's the limit as b approaches infinity of j of b? Basically, as b tends to infinity. Well, that I just explained above is 0. And we actually know the j prime of b function, right? It's this. So let's plug everything in. The integral from 0 to infinity of negative b over b squared plus 1 db is equal to negative j. Cancel out the negatives proudly, implying that j is equal to. Now we actually need to integrate this. So you see that we can have the derivative of the denominator in the numerator if we have a 2b. So let's multiply and divide by half. Half of the integral from 0 to infinity of 2b over b squared plus 1 dB. Now you may try to do some u substitution in case you aren't familiar with derivative of denominator over denominator form of an integral. But I'll just leave that as an exercise to you in case you doubt me. So with half of the natural log of b squared plus 1, because b squared plus 1 is always going to be positive, we don't need an absolute value, evaluated from infinity to 0. So j is nothing but half of the integral, the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 1 minus half of the natural log of when b is going to go to 0, we have 1 here. Natural log of 1 is 0, so this goes to 0. And we just have this natural log function that's literally blowing to infinity. The natural log of b squared plus 1, the limit as b approaches infinity. Let's just write this as it is and let's hope that this cancels out with something in the future. So since we now know what j is, we can finally have an expression for I1. So I1 is 3 over 4 plus 3 over 4 times what was j. So j was half of the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 1. So let's take it out of the bracket now. Plus we have a 3 over 8 over here, times the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 1. So that's our I1. Nice. Now time to do our I2. So what's our I2? I2 is basically 1 over 4 times the integral from 0 to infinity of sine of 3x divided by x squared dx. So essentially we are going to adopt a similar procedure like we applied on part 1 or I1. So we need to do integration by parts to reduce the power of the denominator. So we're going to be having the negative because of the antiderivative of 1 over x squared, negative 1 over x times the sine of 3x divided by x, evaluated from 0 to infinity, and minus integral now from 0 to infinity of so we have cosine of 3x, but don't forget the 3 because of the chain rule and the over 4 because of, you know, it was already a constant outside, divided by x, and that's a negative x, right, because that's the antiderivative of 1 over x squared. So that negative over here and this negative will make a positive. Don't forget the dx. So now it's time to actually evaluate this at infinity. So, well, the interesting part about sines and cosines is that although you may have any real constant multiplied with the x, they're always going to oscillate between negative 1 and 1. They're always, the amplitude is always going to be 1. No matter what constant there is multiplied with the argument of the sine or the cosine. So again, at infinity, as x approaches infinity, sine of 3x again is going to oscillate from minus infinity, minus 1 to 1, like a sine of x. So it's going to have some value in between there, and we don't need to worry about that. All we need to worry about is this x in the denominator. So as x approaches infinity, sine of 3x will oscillate. We don't care. X will become really, really large. The denominator becomes really large. That makes this entire fraction go to zero at infinity. And then we have a minus because of this original negative, and the second minus because of subtracting the lower bound. So that makes a positive here. And we have 1 over 4 times the limit as x goes to 0 of sine of 3x divided by x plus, and now I'm going to call this thing, this integral p. This is going to be p excluding the 3 over 4 outside. So we're going to be having 3 over 4 times p. Now, how do we calculate this limit? Well, to calculate this limit, basically use our sign identity on limits. We need to match the inner argument with the denominator. So there's a 3x in the argument of the sign. We need a 3x in the denominator. To maintain equality, we'll have to multiply a 3x over here. And as x approaches 0, 3x also approaches 0. So this thing entirely will go to 1 now, leaving us with just a positive 3 over 4 plus 3 over 4 times our p. Let's do p on a separate page. See you there. So we had our p being equal to the integral from 0 to infinity of cosine of 3x divided by x dx. So like the time we did our j, we again want to get rid of our x. So we want to use Leibniz rule again. So we parameterize it now. Say p of b. Now this b and that b is just a dummy variable. I mean, there is no connection between them. You could have any other letter, say t or s or r or anything else. Integral from 0 to infinity of e raised to negative bx. Same reason as using e raised to negative bx the last time. Times the cosine of 3x. The reason is because it converges over x dx. Now time to perform our differentiation with respect to b. We get integral from 0 to infinity of negative e raised to negative bx times x times cosine of 3x divided by x dx. The x will proudly cancel out. That was our entire purpose of using the Leibniz rule. We have the integral from 0 to infinity negative e raised to negative bx times the cosine of 3x dx. Now it's again time to use integration by parts. So the negative and the antiderivative, the negative due to the antiderivative of the e raised to negative bx is well compensated. We don't need to care about that. So now we have e raised to negative bx cosine of 3x as it is divided by b, because there was a coefficient associated with the argument x. But that is evaluated from 0 to infinity again, minus integral from 0 to infinity this time of e raised to negative bx, and the derivative of cosine of 3x is negative sine of 3x times 3. So that negative and this negative will become a positive. We have a 3 and a b because of this, the antiderivative of e raised to negative bx. And don't forget the sine of 3x term and the dx. So that's basically our p prime of b. Now let's evaluate that this part as x goes to infinity. So as x goes to infinity, cosine of 3x again, like the sine of 3x, will oscillate between negative 1 and 1. E raised to negative bx as x goes to infinity will decay down to 0. So this entire term will go to 0 the first time at the upper limit of integration. And when x is 0, cosine of 0 is 1, e raised to 0 is 1. So we have a 1 over b, a negative 1 over b. Because we were subtracting the upper minus the lower. So minus sign was retained. Plus, now again we need to perform integration by parts on this. So I'll be taking a negative 3 over b outside, like our last time. So negative 3 over b times, well, because of the negative, the negative due to the antiderivative of the e raised to negative bx is compensated again. E raised to negative bx times the sine of 3x as it is, divided by a fresh b evaluated from 0 to infinity minus integral from 0 to infinity of e raised to negative bx. The derivative of sine of 3x is 3 times cosine of 3x and a fresh b again. Don't forget the dx. And I'll close this square bracket here. So now basically our p prime of b is going to be negative 1 over b. And when x tends to infinity, sine of 3x will oscillate between negative 1 and 1. E raised to negative bx will decay, making this thing 0. And also at 0, because sine of 0 is 0, everything will go to 0. And we have plus, the negative and negative will make a positive, and a 3 and a 3 will make a 9. And the b and b will make a b squared. 9 over b squared times the integral from 0 to infinity of e raised to negative bx times the cosine of 3x dx. And if we notice, if we go back up, this new integral that we obtained is just negative of this, right? Negative of p prime of b. So let's make the appropriate substitutions now. So we have p prime of b being equal to negative 1 over b plus, rather minus, 9 over b squared times our p prime of b. So doing our appropriate algebra, I won't show all the steps now. We have p prime of b being finally equal to negative b over b squared plus 1. You know, I just skipped a lot of steps of the algebra. We rearranged everything to make p prime of b the subject of the equation, and we got this. So now it's again time to integrate with respect to b, and we need to find our upper and lower bounds. So now notice that the limit as b approaches infinity of p of b, well, the e raised to negative bx will decay as b goes to infinity, will be 0. And p when b is equal to 0 is going to be just our regular p that we wanted to calculate, right? The special case. So again, our limits of integration are for 0, far from 0 to infinity. So 0 to infinity of p prime of b dB, and by the fundamental theorem of calculus, we have limit as b approaches infinity of b minus p of 0, which, well, this thing will go to 0 as discussed, and this will be our p, so negative p. But the fun fact is we know p prime of b, so let's integrate that. Integral from 0 to infinity of negative b over b squared plus 1 is equal to negative p. Negatives can cancel out. Now again, if we were to integrate by the same technique as j, we'll obtain, I'm really sorry guys, this is b squared plus 9 because of this 9 on the top. So even this is b squared plus 9, so I'm really sorry for that. Didn't see that coming. So half of the natural log of b squared plus 9, again this is going to be positive from 0 to infinity, evaluated from infinity to 0. So time to plug everything in now. So we're going to be having p is equal to half of the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 9 minus half of natural log of when b is 0, we have just have a 9. And I would just like to make a simple substitution now. A simplification. Limit as b approaches infinity then of the natural log of b squared plus 9. And well, what is natural log of 9? That's the natural log of 3 squared, right? So we can bring the power down to have 2 times the natural log of 3 over 2 because of this half. So we have minus the natural log of 3. That's our p, right? So we can now plug in our I2 finally. We know our p. So for I2, now we have 3 over 4 plus 3 over 4 times half of the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 9 minus natural log of 3 here. So let's just expand the bracket. 3 over 4 plus 3 over 8 times the limit as b goes to infinity of natural log of b squared plus 9 minus 3 over 4 times the natural log of 3. Well, we have our I1, we have our I2. It's time for the final end game now. See you on a fresh page. So now if you recall what we defined I to be, we defined I to be I1 minus I2, the difference between I1 and I2. So what is I1? What did we obtain as I1? So I1 was 3 over 4. 3 over 4 plus 3 over 8 times the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 1 minus, and what was our I2? 3 over 4 plus 3 over 8 times the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 9 minus a 3 over 4 times a natural log of 3 term. So why don't we get rid of the bracket. So 3 over 4 plus 3 over 8 times the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 1 minus 3 over 4 minus 3 over 8 times the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 9, and the minus and minus will make a plus, 3 over 4 times a natural log of 3. So now the best part, a sight for sore eyes, is the 3 over 4 cancel off, and we have this 3 over 4 times the natural log of 3 term. Why don't we take the 3 over 8 common over here? So 3 over 8 common times the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 1 minus the limit as b goes to infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 9. So we have I to be finally be 3 over 4 times the natural log of 3. Why don't we take a common log for these? We can use log property certainly. 3 over 8 times the limit as b approaches infinity of the natural log of b squared plus 1 divided by b squared plus 9. Nice. So we have 3 over 4 times the natural log of 3, and we can take the limit inside because of the continuous nature of the natural log. So 3 over 8 times the natural log of the limit as b approaches infinity of b squared plus 1 divided by b squared plus 9. And now let's use our simple limit calculation tricks. So you have 3 over 4 times the natural log of 3 plus 3 over 8 times the limit, the natural log first, times the limit as b goes to infinity of, why don't we divide everything by b squared in the numerator and the denominator? So we have 1 plus 1 over b squared divided by 1 plus 9 over b squared. And now as b goes to infinity, this fraction will go to 0 because the denominator is increasing really rapidly. So will this. So 1 plus 0 divided by 1 plus 0. So that's just 1. And the natural log of 1, you guessed it right, is 0. So this entire thing will go to 0. And that's a great thing because the limit as b approaches infinity of the natural log separately say the limit as b approaches 0 as the natural log of b squared plus 1 was yielding an infinity, right? And it's a great thing that all these infinities are finally cancelling out, dying down to 0. So finally we have I being equal to 3 over 4 times the natural log of 3. That's a pretty neat and a finite result. And this is approximately 0.82395. So we have a finite answer for our integral. So that's nice, that's beautiful. So now to finally conclude, we had our integral that we calculated today, the integral from 0 to infinity of sine cubed x divided by x squared dx being equal to 3 over 4 times the natural log of 3. Now before ending the video, I would like to point out a very interesting fact to you. Notice that the integrand is an odd function because the x squared is even but the sine cubed will be always odd. And in case you can't seem to think of any applications of having an odd function, let's do a simple substitution. You know, just for fun, let's do a simple substitution. So in the same integral, let u equal negative x such that we have du being equal to negative dx. So x is therefore negative u, right? So we have I now, the same thing, because we just performed simple substitution. That doesn't destroy our equality. When x is 0, u is 0. When x goes to infinity, u goes to negative infinity. And instead of an x, we'll have sine cubed of negative u divided by negative u the whole thing squared, and dx is negative du. Okay, so we have the integral from 0 to negative infinity. What's sine cubed of negative u? Well, it's sine of negative u, everything to the third power. And a square of a negative number is always a positive u squared. We have a negative du over here. Well, a sine of a negative angle is a negative sine and a negative sine cubed. So negative sine cubed is basically negative 1 cubed times sine cubed, and negative 1 cubed is negative 1. So we have that negative 1 because of this numerator and this negative cancelling out. So you have the integral from 0 to negative infinity. That's our I being defined as the sine cubed of u over u squared times du. Now notice our limits of integral, our bounds of integration. It's from 0 to negative infinity, right? So negative infinity is, if you look at our traditional number line, is way smaller than 0. So we actually want to write this integral in terms of from negative infinity to 0. So let's put a negative up front. That will enable us to flip our upper and lower bound of integration. So we have integral from negative infinity to 0 of sine cubed of u over u squared du. That's our I, right? But what is I if we look at what it was initially? Integral from 0 to infinity of sine cubed of x over x squared dx. So we have the integral from 0 to infinity of sine cubed of x over x squared dx being equal to, now the negative of, well, another property of definite integration is it doesn't matter what variable we have inside provided we have the same upper and lower bounds. So we can, instead of u, we can just write an x, sine cube of x over x squared dx. Why don't we add this thing on both the sides? So then we have the integral from 0 to infinity of sine cubed of x over x squared dx plus integral from negative infinity now to 0 of sine cubed of x over x squared dx being equal to 0 because we added this on both the sides. So now by the linearity of this integral, an integral from negative infinity to 0 plus integral from 0 to infinity is nothing but integral from negative infinity to infinity of the sine cube of x over x squared dx. But interestingly now, this time this is equal to 0. So the integral just from 0 to infinity is 3 over 4 times the natural log of 3. And therefore, the integral from negative infinity to 0 must be negative of this. So negative 3 over 4 times the natural log of 3. And when you add both of them, such as to obtain integral from negative infinity to infinity, that becomes a 0 because it's an odd function. So its graph would somewhat be like this. So this positive area will get cancelled with this negative area as we go from negative infinity to our positive infinity. So that was basically how symmetry works. That's it for this video, guys. Please like, share and subscribe. Recommend me to your friends. If you have any doubts, you can reach me in the comment section. Stay home, stay safe. Have a great day. Peace out.